It's a beautiful day for worship. Before we get started, please take out your mobile device and check in on the Church Center app. If you're joining us online, please select online service. If you're joining us in person, select on site. If you're on site today, we have just a few housekeeping items. We're delighted that children are joining us today. Pastor Sadie has put together busy bee bags, and they're available in the foyer. There are also a few tables available in the back of the auditorium for families with young children. Hey kids, please stay with the parent today at all times. And parents, please escort your children to the restroom and do not send them by themselves. Our offering today will be collected online via the Church Center app, our website, or text to give. There are also giving buckets located in the back of the auditorium. Prepackaged communion has been made available in Ziploc bags at each seating section. Communion is going to be a to-go style. Please take your bags with you as you leave and partake in your car or once you return home. At the end of the service, please remain seated until an usher dismisses you. You will be released by sections to ensure a safe departure. For those of you joining us online, we thank you for tuning in. We so appreciate the opportunity to connect with you. We pray this service is a blessing. No matter where you are today, we love you and we're grateful that you've joined us. Let's worship God together right now.
Your love is stronger. Your love awakens. If you're a dad, you're not afraid to work hard.
Never give up.
Never compromise.
And the best dads always look for ways to get better.
I'm looking for something to energize me.
I'm looking for something to push me further.
And I'm looking for something to go with these nachos.
Dad Fuel, the energy drink designed just for dads.
So I can finish the fight.
So I can finish the race.
So I can finish mowing the lawn. And later on, I might watch some golf.
The fuel dads need to do the things dads do.
Climb the highest peak.
Go the furthest distance.
Check the scores. Read the newspaper. Give amazing relationship advice.
Why are you crying?
You should really talk to your mother about that.
Dad Fuel comes loaded with taurine, ginseng, and 100% of your daily recommended value of Hi, Hungry, I'm Dad.
I start every morning with the four D's. Devo's Donuts. Dad Fuel, down blanket. Breakfast of champions, baby.
Now available in four bold flavors. Original orange, role model raspberry, Growmaster mango, and I thought I told you to take out the garbage grape.
You can't touch my passion.
You can't touch my drive.
And you definitely can't touch my thermostat. No way.
So whether you're thirsty for victory,
or just plain thirsty.
No, seriously, it's empty. Can I get another one?
Dad Fuel.
Because I am fearless.
Because I am unstoppable.
Because the players on TV aren't gonna yell at themselves.
Come on! Throw the ball!
It's only funny because it's true, right? Yeah, that's right. So let me ask you guys this morning, this has been bothering me all week. I gotta know, what do you call a fake noodle? Does anybody know? An imposter, that's right. So we wanted to start today off with a really lame dad joke in the spirit of Father's Day. And so I appreciate that some of you knew that. That means you're just as lame as I am. So good morning, church. What a beautiful day it is. What a beautiful weekend. A little hot, but still beautiful to celebrate dads. Father's Day 2020, right? And we know, although, you know, 2020 has not necessarily been the ideal year for many of us, that won't stop us from celebrating some amazing people in our lives known as dads. So for those of you in attendance and those of you watching at home online, whether you're live or watching this later, I want to also mention to the people at home, if we have any audio issues today, we will be reposting this later on today, so you'll be able to view it without the issues if they arise. And let's just hope and pray that they don't. But let's take a moment today and collectively, let's just pray together. Could you pray with me? Father God, we come together today to celebrate Father's Day, but God, most importantly, to celebrate our one true Father, God, and that's you. Lord, we pray that as we hear from a few different voices today, God, we pray that your Spirit moves, God, that you remove us and place your Spirit in our lives and in our voices and in our words. Lord, calm our nerves, give us steady minds, strong hearts to speak your truth. Lord, we're so thankful to meet together today and be one body. In Jesus' name, everybody says, amen. I want to say this up front really quickly, that we understand that not everyone has a warm and fuzzy feeling when we think, or when we talk rather, about the dad topic, right? We want to make it known that we do understand that dad can be a very difficult and maybe even hurtful topic for many of us. And so with that in mind, we have outlined some space in our digital bulletin, journal space, if you will, for those of you that may be dealing with some kind of hurt or some kind of pain in regards to all things dad, that you're able to maybe journal those thoughts or those feelings, and we hope as a church to partner together with you in the healing process of that through the power of God. And so let me ask, what does it mean to be a dad? Well, it can mean, as many of you know, many, many things in many situations. And one thing that we do know, no matter how we define the dad role in your life or maybe in the life of your children, maybe, we know that the dad role is a most important role. Did you know that when a father comes to Christ, when a dad comes to Christ, that his family will join in that acceptance some 93% of the time? Dads, if you didn't know, whether you're here or watching online, now you know the major kingdom influence that you have. just by being dad. Fatherhood is important, a hood that I can say I'm proudly a part of with my three children. And I want to take a moment to acknowledge those of us out there in the world today that are not biological dads, that have stepped into the life of a young child and have been dad. And I know that there's a lot of good men out there that have done this, and what a blessing you are in the lives of those children. I want to encourage you today. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 4 says this to fathers. Fathers, do not provoke your children to anger by the way that you treat them. Rather, bring them up with the discipline and the instruction that comes from the Lord, our Father. We see this ultimate form of fatherhood from and by our God, the Father in heaven. A verse that many of you are familiar with that I'm going to go ahead and read anyway, because even though some of us, the church folks here, we probably haven't memorized, those of you that don't, maybe hear it for the first time, but it's worth reading. The perfect example of a loving father, John 3:16, for this is how God, our Father, loved the world. He gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him will not perish, but have eternal life. That is a father's love, a love that gives life. Well, this morning you may have noticed some faces behind me here. I've got a few partners today that have come to help me share about fatherhood or being a father from their vantage point. And today we pray that they're comfortable to share with us today, and that they're going to share whatever God has laid on their heart this week as they've prepared. And they will introduce themselves fully. But first I want to invite my friend, my brother, John, to the microphone. So John, come on up. Let's give him a round of applause.
Good morning, guys. Just in case you were wondering, he did wear the same shoes as I did. He texted me this morning and wanted to find out what I was wearing. So, no, it was totally unplanned. But bear with me. This may be a bit choppy. He just told me this morning that I'd be doing this. I'm just kidding. Totally kidding. So before I start, I do have a serious question. I was wondering if you guys could tell me why the golfer brought two pairs of pants to the golf course.
I have no idea.
Casey got a hole in one. That's right. That's right. So I was told this is our weekend. We can tell as many bad dad jokes as we want, unlimited. So feel free to let loose. So like Pastor Brian said, you know, my name is John Baker. I'm a single father. Of an 11, almost 12-year-old stud muffin, Kai, sitting over here. Kai, stand up. Say hi. Once again, I feel it's my duty to embarrass him, so I had to do that. Like I said, I am a single father, so although his mom and I are separated, we have a really good relationship. It's something that we set out early to do, to show him that even though we had a broken relationship, that we could still be cordial, we could still have a good relationship, a good friendship. And really, it's really we were talking on the way over, it's an extended family. We celebrate holidays together, we swim at their pool. It's just a really good relationship and something we wanted to do for him early on. We knew we wanted to put him first. So something we're proud of, and I think we've carried out really well. So from Indianapolis, Indiana, currently reside in the Center Grove and Greenwood area. Pretty much been in sales, my entire adult life. And still currently in wireless business sales. So, I'll jump in kind of my faith journey. Like I said, it may be all over, but give you guys a little bit of perspective. So I grew up in church most of my life, from young. My mom, Sandy Baker, she attends here. Some of you may know her. She played an integral part in my faith journey, and I know without her, I definitely wouldn't be here where I am today. So, Mom, if you're watching, I love you. But she always made sure we were involved in church. So the first years, early on, we studied with the Jehovah's Witnesses. So if you don't know, the background of Jehovah's Witnesses, as a kid, it was detrimental to me. They didn't celebrate holidays, birthdays. We didn't celebrate Christmas. For me, that was rough, right? Being a kid and growing up and not getting to share in those things. So, my dad and I, we had a... it's always been a challenged relationship, never been too close. But he was an advocate for that, for those reasons. Sadly enough, his motivation was financially driven. They didn't pass around a collection plate at church. You know, he just had a really skewed view on pastors and church, and you know, he didn't want to support financially. That was really his driving factor as to why we studied with them. So that was early on. So, you know, if you fast forward a few years, around my seventh or eighth grade year, like I said, I was born on the east side of Indy, really close to downtown. If you're not familiar, you know, it's a high crime area. You know, I know growing up, you know, we had bikes, numerous bikes that were stolen. You know, I was jumped or beat up on more than one occasion. I remember pretty much in our front yard, one of my dad's best friends was, and not to be too dark, but he was shot point blank over a drug deal. So, you know, it was rough. And so the final straw, and I'll get to a point eventually, but the final straw, I had a good friend of mine. He was about a year or two ahead of me, and he lived right across the street. And he went to Tech High School, and Tech's a rough school. And he came home, and he was beat up pretty bad. And at that time, my mom was, you know, you're not going to public school, basically. And, you know, she set to enroll me in homeschooling because that's the only way she knew to go. So, you know, eighth grade year, I'm being homeschooled. And it's all right. You know, it's definitely different, not something that I really enjoyed, per se. You know, but my mom was really good at finding outlets, and so she enrolled me, and there was a basketball program. And so if you know me, you know I love basketball and I love playing. So, you know, she enrolled me. It was called the Golden Eagles. Got to play on a real team. It was pretty cool. And so I remember we played against a school called Baptist Academy, which is a Christian school here locally in Indy. And we had a game against them, and I showed up pretty well that game, and the coaches came up after. And they talked to my mom and I and asked us if I'd be interested in playing there. And I was. My mom was on board. Once again, it came back to, you know, my dad. He was pretty much the breadwinner. So he didn't want to pay. Once again, it was financially driven. It was a private school. He thought I'd be fine in public school, but my mom just wasn't having it. And so she fought that fight, and ultimately she won. So transition a little bit. Freshman year, I'm enrolled. So this is really when, you know, my life and faith journey kind of took a turn for the better. So that's when I remember sitting in, we were in Bible class or homeroom or something. We had a teacher, Mr. Willis. He was also our youth pastor. And I remember somehow we got on a sidebar conversation, and he asked me if I was saved. And, you know, I had no idea what that meant. And so I told him that. And he pretty much immediately took me to his office. You know, we walked through some scripture, Romans Road, and I said the prayer that day and accepted Christ as my Savior. So right there in school. So that was, you know, a pretty cool experience. But, you know, even then, I didn't fully understand and didn't really pursue a relationship with Christ. You know, I treated it almost as if I had some sort of fire insurance, right? Or you know, I profess my faith and I'm good to go. So that's really where I began my journey. So, you know, to kind of put it all together, I've been saved for almost 23 years, which as I was putting this together was kind of crazy to think about. It's not until this last year I've intentionally pursued a relationship with Christ. And I think a lot of that comes from being a dad. So earlier in the week, you know, Brian sent over a template just with a few questions to kind of, you know, start some dialogue and things like that. So the first one was, how does, you know, being a dad shaped your faith? So for me, you know, being a dad has really put the love of Christ into perspective. You know, if you're a parent, you know, a mom or a dad, you know, beyond a shadow of a doubt, there's nothing that your kid can do that'll make you love them any less at all. And so much so that you would, like Brian said earlier, you would lay down your life for them, right? So you don't, and if you don't have kids, you know, you may not understand that kind of love, but it's almost unexplainable. But it's there. So for me, it's really put that in a perspective. And for God to give his only son, I couldn't imagine having to, you know, sacrifice Kai for, you know, a generation of, you know, and a world of people. So it, I don't know, it's just, it just definitely puts it in perspective for me. So, you know, the next question is, what's the most difficult part about being a dad? And so to me, it's living the example, right? So, you know, as parents, we've probably all said, do as I say, not as I do, right? Listen to me. But ultimately, You know, our children are going to do what we do. That's why it's very important that we model and live as close to Christ as we possibly can. It's very important that we represent that and that we show our children what that looks like. And then lastly, the question is, what is a dad golden nugget? So my golden nugget, you know, would be to leave your kids with the hope of Jesus Christ. It's great if you can leave them money or a house or a car, memories, you know, any of that. But there's really nothing more important than the hope, the love, and the peace that we have with our Lord and Savior. That's kind of my mission. So as I wrap up, you know, if you're a parent or, you know, a dad and you have children, you know, my challenge would be to pursue Christ and live and model him as closely as you can. And that way our children do have a chance to make it. It's a crazy world, so we want to give them as much hope as we can. So, fine. That's all I got, guys. Thank you.
All right, I'm just super happy. John's one of my closest friends, so that was just really cool for me personally. But now, I want to introduce one of the coolest guys that I know, Bill.
He doesn't know many.
Hang on, let me get my iPad going here.
Here, you can borrow mine.
Yeah, I walk up here and these guys' iPads. Here's my notes. Anyway.
Hey, the paper never shuts off, so you're good.
All right. Good point. You've got a point there. Keep your hat on, nobody will see it. Okay. Of course, you know, Brian came to me and asked me if I would, you know, do this, and I, yeah, no problem. So he gave us this guideline here, which, you know, that definitely helps with me because I have no memory. I can't tell you what I had for supper last night, so I need something in front of me, you know, and so I'm going to go through it kind of like he was asking me questions. And the first one, as John said, is the intro. I am Bill Reynolds, and a short bio would be that Bluff Creek Christian Church, I mean, I was raised here. There was a short period of time I didn't come here, but I did go to church elsewhere, and now I'm back. But prior to that, I mean, my parents were active, very active members in this church. My grandparents on both sides, very active members in this church. We got a lot of history here. And it makes me proud to see that history going on through Sadie and hopefully my grandchildren. So there's a certain amount of family pride within the real estate here, if you will, but even more as far as Christianity. I have two daughters, and Arnie is one of them. She's the children's pastor here. The other one is Sybil Bell. She lives in Tennessee. Very proud of both of them. Invested a little bit of time in them. And of course, you know, I hope you can see this. Awesome, like my daughters.
Who bought the shirt, though?
Now, that's where we're going.
Okay.
Yes, I was given this morning. I did not buy the shirt. And I look at it, and I'm like, how do you react? I know, I'm not that dumb. I know this can be taken two ways, okay? I was awesome, and I raised my daughters, and they're awesome. Yeah. I know these two knuckleheads I raised. Okay? No. In their minds, because Sadie called her sister and said, you know, she'd found this t-shirt, and she said, yeah, get it for him. Sybil did. I know those two, they're saying, yep, we're awesome, and we made him awesome. Yeah. Sadie, you hear her? Amen. Uh-huh. Okay, well, anyway, I'm very proud of them, and I'm glad to call them my daughters. I'm glad they made me a father. Anyway, one thing that comes with daughters is son-in-laws. People would say, oh, don't you wish you had a son? I said, no, well, they'll come. Boys will come. And they did. Sybil's married to Brian. He's a drug driver. And Mike Arnie is Sadie's husband. And he's doing the AV around. He's a geek. He's handy to have around. You get computer problems, like if real iPad, he can fix it. Anyway, he's back here somewhere. But here's the other thing that son-in-laws get you. We must be a t-shirt family, right? This came from Mike. Any of you can't see, it says, hold on. Let me overthink this. That's what my son-in-law thinks of me. Okay, moving right along, I'm supposed to tell you my occupation. I work at the Bartersville Wastewater Treatment Plant. I refer to myself as a poopologist. I know poop about poop, okay? Okay, moving right. But my faith, my journey through my faith, like I said, I was raised in church. And my mother and father made sure that I was at church. And my sisters, I have two sisters that are older than myself. Yeah, I'm the baby. They made sure that all three of us were at church. And not every time the doors opened, but every Sunday. Every Sunday night, because church used to be on Sunday night also. And then when we became teenagers, every youth group. And I enjoyed it for a while. Got to where I didn't so much enjoy it. And that's about the time Mom would say, you're going to go and you're going to enjoy it. That's the kind of mother I had. And I went, and I'm glad she made me. But I didn't always enjoy it. As time went on, I kind of became my own person. I kept coming to church to keep my parents happy, more so than for myself. I mean, I was baptized, you know, at a young age, which most kids now, at that time it was considered young, but now most kids get baptized younger. But I was baptized, and I believed in Jesus, and I believed he was the Son of God, and I believed that he would get me to heaven. You know, I believed it all. But it became kind of unimportant to me through some teenage years and did things I wasn't proud of. But ended up, I became a father. And then all of a sudden, God grabbed a hold of my life. And now he became the thing in my life instead of not so important. But I have to trace that back and thank my mother and father for that. Good people, wonderful, wonderful parents. So anyway, you know, as time went on and I delved deeper into the scriptures and tried to understand more and more and talked to other people who weren't of the Christian faith but were of similar faiths, and you know, you get to wondering, and I was exposed to different views and ideas and things, and that kind of led to a little bit of searching, and that's when I didn't attend Bluff Creek, but I attended other places. Eventually, you know, my parents got to a point where they were getting older. They were my age, they weren't elderly. They were getting older, and you know, I wanted to attend church with them. All my beliefs are still the same, that Jesus is the Son of God, that he died that my sins could be forgiven, and that I can live eternally in heaven because of him. And you know, that's the way we all sit here today. So it was easy to come back. I might have some ideas that are different than some of yours, but if we talk to each other, there's a lot of different ideas in here. We all are to work out our own salvation with fear and trembling. That's what it comes down to. That's why it was easy to come back. I could sit with my family who brought me up. I'm rambling, sorry. Anyway, back to this. That's why I'm here today. Brian gave us another topic of thoughts to consider. How's being a dad shaped your faith? Well, my thought is it hasn't. Being a dad did not shape my faith, but my faith shaped me being a dad. Because of my faith, I have a direction I want to see my kids and my grandkids go. That keeps me busy, that faith. I always come back to it. Well, as a dad, or, you know, I'm a grandparent also. There's parent in that. I'm parent to my daughters, but I'm still a parent to those grandkids. So I come back to that. How do I guide them towards eternal life? This is just life. Some of you whose kids have been in class with me over across, one thing I keep saying, this is just life. That's all it is. We make it too important. This is to get us to eternal life. And that thought is what helps me be a dad, not dad helping me have that thought. I was supposed to tell you about our family situation. It's Sadie likes to refer to it, and I do too, you know, as being multi-generational, our home life. Sounds cool, doesn't it? It's succotash is what it is. Any of you that know what succotash is, it's when the old farm gal took the corn and the beans that were left over, mixed them together, and there was a new meal. That's what we are. We're all under one roof. We all, you know, we eat supper together. We do a lot of things together and all that, but we are still two different families. Sadie and Mike have their family, and we actually have, Jesselyn and I actually have ours. We have a great niece who we are guardians of, who I don't think of as a great niece. She's just another grandchild. If the three of them are standing there and you come up and I don't know you very well and I'm going to introduce her as a grandchild because that's how I feel about her. All, you know, they're all important. But anyway, in this succotash, it gives us the ability, though, to have a lot of help in raising these children. You know, there was a lady that coined an African proverb, and I believe she was right. The African proverb was right. You know, it takes a village to raise a child. We have that benefit within our house because of being multi-generational. Sometimes there's probably wisdom that we can lend to the younger parents in our house, and there's also times when they can bring more modern thoughts into some of these old brain cells here. So it's win-win in my opinion. Okay, now back to where I was. What's the most difficult part of being a dad? Man, you gotta realize kids are always changing. They're born, they're easy. You feed them, you change their diapers, you keep them clean, try to keep them quiet, you're done. They get a little bit older. They've got more needs now. They got to where they want toys. They want to do things. They want you to play. You know, that was good too, because I was still a kid too. Jesselyn had to raise one more kid than I did, because she's raised me. But then we kept, you know, and then your kids grow on, and oh no, adolescence. Now they're starting to really get some ideas, opinions. Then they become teenagers. Oh no, you know what that is, any of you that's raised kids. They're not the same 2 days in a row, let alone for a week, you know. So, but as a parent, you got to kind of assess the situation. Where are they at today, you know? I didn't always do that. A lot of times I would jump at the problem, grab it by the horns and try to deal with it, you know, harshly. One benefit to getting older is you can kind of slow down and you can think about things a little more. And so now I try to do a little better job of taking my time, what's going on with this kid at this moment. And I believe God has gave me that wisdom, and I want to share that with you. I believe he put it on my heart today to share that with you. Pay attention to where that kid's at, and not just react to something, but assess it before you react. Here we go with, what are some early parent fears you had to wrestle with, and how did God see you through? One of my fears, I saw kids when my kids were really little that were older that I didn't want my kids to be like. So I went about making them not like those kids, which probably made me much more strict than I possibly needed to be at times. Maybe not. I mean, both the girls turned out pretty good. Who knows? It doesn't matter. I don't lose sleep about it, you know. But I think probably early on, you know, I was too concerned about my children being perfect or not annoying other people, that type of thing. Where do you turn in times of hardship? What best practices do you use? There's been several hardships through our life. We've encountered a lot of things with our children. And the advice I would give to parents now, deal with common sense, first of all. Well, you say, well, you ought to look to God first. I'm sorry, but I feel like God gave you common sense. You don't have to go to him and ask him every little thing. You've had people do that to you. They won't blink their eyes without asking you about it. God doesn't want us asking every little thing. You got common sense. Use it. A kid needs something, wants something, and you know it's no good for them? Say no. Don't say, I'll pray about it and get back to you. Say no. There are going to be things, though, that, yes, deal with prayer. We've had that. There's been several times I've had to, you know, God, I don't know. What do I do? And then wait, because he does usually provide, he does provide the answer. Not as fast as I want, like we all say, but he does provide the answer. Sometimes it definitely won't be your answer, but go with his. What was the next thing you put here, Brian? Common sense prayer.
Let's go with the golden nugget.
No, you're wrong.
Not the first time.
Okay, no. Really, I like him. Don't tell him. The dad lens. He says, you know, final thoughts through their dad lens. When I look through my dad lens and parenthood, it's as time's gone on and experiences have came, I came to appreciate the kids more, their situation more, what they're dealing with more. It's made me move a little slower, not work with things harshly. It's made me look at other people's kids and understand better. All those kids are in a different situation. It's helped me to realize that I have some responsibility, not just to the ones under my roof, but also to your kids too. How can I help you? I'm you know, like I've referred to the village. How can I be a part of that village to help you? Because I certainly need your help in my household. Now the golden nugget, and I'm going to tell you what I was going to skip that one. Sorry about your luck. A word of encouragement for dads struggling right now. Raise children so that you can stand before God and say, I've done everything I could do, God. It may not be right. Everything may not have worked out exact, but as long as you're putting forth all the effort and trying to do things as right as possible before God, not before your neighbor, not before your wife, not before your parents, but before God, you can stand in front of him and say, yeah, I goofed a few times, but God, my heart was sincere. I was really trying to do everything that you wanted me to do. And I do believe in the scripture, the old scripture, Proverbs 22:6 says, start a child off on the way they should go, and even when they are old, they will not turn from it. I believe that scripture. I've seen it too many times in my life. I've seen it myself from the time that I totally rebelled against God. But my mom and dad were fervent. They still kept teaching me. I came back. I've seen it in siblings, or not siblings, but I've seen it in friends and that I had growing up. But I've also seen the other where they weren't taught. And they did not come back around, or to date, they have not came back around. The teaching when they're young is very important. I'm done.
All right. Thank you, Bill.
Are there any questions? Brian will be glad to answer them.
Thanks to both of them for coming and sharing with us this morning. I know it's a little different than what we're used to, but we thought, you know, as a staff, as leadership, that it might be good to hear from some other voices, just some other perspectives. And both of them, as I think through what they said, had a lot of good little, I'm stuck on this phrase, golden nugget, and I can say it because it's Father's Day. But this golden nugget, they had a lot of them, both of them, that we can use as dads, as parents, and ultimately as believers. Let's pray, and then we'll have a worship song. God, thank you so much for the opportunity to come together. God, thank you for these hearts of these men willing to share, Lord, be with us today, God. I pray that maybe if we have questions or something we heard that we want to know more about, God, I pray we'll come together, feel encouraged to do that, God. If you spoke to our hearts today and we feel compelled to make a decision for you, Lord, I pray that will happen today as well, God. It's in Jesus' name, amen.
See, was a struggle. Haunted by ghosts that lived in my past. Bound up in shackles of all my prisoner and say to me, son, stop fighting a fight that's already been won. I am redeemed. You set me free. So I'll shake up these heavy chains.
So, okay, I'm like my dad. I'm old school. I got my paper here. So I want to thank Brian, John, and my dad, Bill, the most awesome dad around, for the special Father's Day that they did. I have a few announcements, and then we're going to let you go. If you're interested in baptism today, please go to the fireside room. It's right out this right side set of doors, and then you turn right, go down to the end of the hallway, and there'll be someone in there to discuss it with you. And if you're watching online, just put baptism in the comment section, and we'll have someone get back with you. If you should have your communion bags in your chairs. If you didn't get one, or if you don't have enough, let one of the ushers know, and we will get you more, or get you one. We also ask that you wait till the ushers come to release you. And we have some technical difficulties, I guess, so let everyone know that our service is going to air at 11 a.m. today. We hope you have a wonderful day, especially you dads, and we'll see you next week. Bye.